This is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another episode of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your podcast co-host. We have a fascinating episode for you today. It's titled Your Monthly Growth Plan. Looking forward to sharing some great information that you can apply to your practice to create a growing practice. Before we get to that episode, two quick announcements to make. Coming up about a month after we publish this episode is our next Thriving Dentist Masterclass. A masterclass is a three-hour course. It's done by live stream. It's done virtually by live stream. This one is titled Grow Your Practice 10% or More Every Year. That masterclass will be Wednesday evening, December 6th. Wanted to encourage you to come join us. We timed it so this would be near the end of the year. So for those of you that are thinking ahead, making plans to make 2024 your best year yet, that masterclass will give you lots of information to facilitate growth, which actually is a nice feed into today's podcast episode. If you'd like more information, you'd like to attend that masterclass, go to thrivingdentist.com/masterclass. It's 3 hours, one evening. You'll get 3 hours of CE credits. Very inexpensive, less than $90 tuition. But most importantly, you'll be armed with all kinds of useful information that you can apply to make 2024 your best year yet. Come join us. Love to see you there. The next announcement I have is we have a returning guest. Dr. Mo Budak is joining us. If you're a regular listener to the Thriving Dentist Show, you'll recognize his name. Mo has been presenting an ongoing series in these segments on the history of dentistry. And today is episode number 5, where he's going to talk about dentistry into the modern era. Now, if you're new to the Thriving Dentist Show, you may not have heard his previous episodes. So we're going to catalog those for you. We're going to make it very easy for you to find those. We'll put episodes 1, 2, 3, 4, and now episode 5 all together. If you go to thrivingdentistshow.com, click podcast, just look for today's episode, the one that says your monthly growth plan. Scroll down in the show notes and you'll see links to the video of each one of these episodes. Dr. Budak also makes an extra effort to film them in video, so you can actually watch them in video. He's got all kinds of cool slides and graphics that go along with it. So if you have any interest at all in the history of dentistry, which I suspect you do, you're going to really enjoy this whole series. So with no further delay, here's episode 5, Dr. Mo Budak on the history of dentistry into the modern era.
Hello, folks. Dr. Mo Budak here presenting the history of dentistry in 5 minutes. This episode number 5 is moving into the modern era. In 1665 in London, they kept records for the cause of all death. In August of that year, during 1 week, they had 5,568 fatalities, with teeth grabbing the number 5 spot. So we dentists are responsible for a very high mortality rate. Why? Most of these patients succumb from mortification, which we call now sepsis. This is an infection set in from difficult extraction operations and as a result of unsanitary practices centuries before germ theory and pre-Lister and pre-Pasteur. The germ theory was postulated in the mid-19th century. Leading to the story of our 20th president, James Garfield. In 1881, President Garfield was accosted at the local train station in Washington, D.C., an assassin aimed his gun at him. Garfield turned and ran away and got shot in the back. Luckily, the bullet only pierced his back muscle. But sometime later, a number of medical doctors came riding up to President Garfield and attempted to extract this bullet, this otherwise harmless bullet. Except they used filthy hands, riding it with dirty reins. They didn't wash their hands. They didn't believe in antiseptic at all. And they finally got the bullet out, but leaving behind sepsis. 79 days later, James Garfield died as a result of that. Was he killed by the assassin? I would rather say he was killed by the medical doctors, who refused to accept the germ theory, which was already very well accepted in Europe. Let's talk about Pierre Fauchard. He was a French physician and the father of modern dentistry. He had studied watchmaking, jewelry making, and enameling, so he was adept at fine hand coordination and materials. In 1728, he wrote the textbook Le Chirurgien Dentiste, in which, among other things, he described two chapters for the disputation of the worm theory, that sugar causes caries, and the invention of fixed bridges using abutment crowns. Along in 1760, John Baker came to the colonies. He was the earliest medically trained dentist to arrive. He had a student, a local silversmith by the name of Paul Revere. Yes, Paul Revere was a dentist in Boston in 1770 and 1775. He, too, was a silversmith and engraver, so he also had good hand-eye coordination. He brashly advertised, "I can fix them as well as any surgeon dentist, whoever came from London." He did that purposely to put a dig on the British, whom he hated. He is also noted as the first dentist to perform a dental identity, forensic dentistry, in America. That is, his patient and friend and commanding officer, General Joseph Warren, who was a physician and leader of the Killing Rebels. He was killed in the Battle of Bunker Hill in June of 1775. 1 year later, when the colonialists recovered the land, Paul Revere was sent to identify General Warren, which he did by noting a bridge that he had fabricated out of hippo ivory and silver wire, which he himself had installed in early 1775, also the year of his famed midnight ride. "Listen, my children, and you shall hear of the midnight ride of Paul Revere on the 18th of April in 75. Hardly a man is now alive who remembers that famous day and year." Josiah Flagg was a childhood friend of Paul Revere, and he invented the first dental chair. Moving on to good old George Washington. Well, there's an old Yiddish curse, and it goes like this. "May all but one of your teeth fall out, and may the remaining one have a toothache." Well, that was indeed the case for George Washington. He was completely edentulous except for tooth number 20, and it had an infection in it. In this famous painting by Gilbert Stuart of 1796, we can see some scarring right here from a draining fistulous tract from tooth number 20. He was known to be seen outside the White House carrying an handkerchief and dabbing at the pus and blood. He finally had it extracted. And at the time of this portrait, Gilbert Stuart insisted that his lips be bumped out with pieces of handkerchief to give him normal soft tissue contour. John Greenwood was one of George Washington's dentists. He fabricated four sets of dentures for him. They were not made of wood. This one was fabricated in 1793, used bovine teeth with a base made of lead, and it weighed 3 pounds. They were also problematic for poor George in that he was very cautious of speaking with them for fear of falling out during the second inaugural address in March of 1793. In fact, that speech was reported to be very low volume, and it lasted only 54 seconds, the shortest inaugural speech ever. Calling your attention to Waterloo teeth. During the Battle of Waterloo in the Napoleonic Wars of 1815, 51,000 men died. Waterloo teeth, as they were known, referred to any tooth stolen from the mouths of dead soldiers. Body snatchers followed the armies into battle and returned home with barrels full of teeth, then sold the teeth to dentists to be used to make natural-looking dentures. Here we can see a famous painting by Francisco Goya called The Tooth Robber. This woman can't bear to stand to look at the man who was recently killed, extracting his tooth and covering her face. The only colors in this painting are his blue cape, which probably represents cyanotic death, and his red shoes, probably representing blood. Well, until next time, thank you, and we'll see you.
Welcome back to the Thriving Dentist Coaching and Action segment. This is Naren, your co-host. Before we jump into the coaching and action segment about your monthly growth plan, I want to take a second to thank Dr. Mo Bodak. Thank you, Dr. Bodak, for all the effort you have put in. You've done 5 episodes now, and this one on the modern era of dentistry. That's awesome. So the video is all included. Gary mentioned it. Go to the show notes, find it. Thank you, Dr. Bodak. Today's episode, your monthly growth plan. Gary and I have mutual clients. We started working together perhaps, 6 years ago, 7 years ago. Anyways, we started working with Life Smiles, Gary's practice that he owned at the time, 7 years ago. And since, Gary has referred a lot of his clients, and we have many mutual clients. And when I think about this topic, your monthly growth plan, what I'm reminded of is a particular client. This particular client, I think, joined Gary a couple of years ago, maybe 2.5 years ago. At that time, I believe he was doing 1.4 million and he was flat, meaning he's a good, healthy practice, amazing dentist, very nice human being. You know, everyone loved him. The team loved him. But for some reason, the practice has been stuck at around 1.4 million for like 4+ years. And then Gary talked about this idea of growing, making every year your best year, growing 10% or more every month. And he said to this particular client, hey, can we set a goal of 10% growth this year, you know, versus last year? And he didn't believe Gary because he couldn't do it or couldn't figure out how to do it for 4 years. And Gary said, we have nothing to lose. Let's give it a shot. But the funny thing is, his practice grew 35% before the end of the year. And of course, he was taking home, if I'm not mistaken, $300,000 plus in extra income, you know, meaning he made $300,000 more profit, take-home profit, versus the prior year. And the funny thing is,
I want to emphasize that particular practice did this with the same team and the same hours. In other words, we didn't add more team members. We didn't add more hours. We didn't add more providers. This was a strong solo dentist practice with a nice, strong hygiene department collecting $1.4 million a year. And he was stuck there for the previous 4 years. And the main reason why he became a client is he wanted to figure out some way to get unstuck and start to experience some growth again. And I shared with him, I said, well, how would you feel about 10% growth? He said, well, Gary, based on the fact that I've been plateaued for the last 4 years, I'd be thrilled at 10% growth. And we actually achieved in our first year of working together, we achieved 35% growth, same team, same hours. And it completely blew him away. He said, Gary, I never, if you would have told me at the beginning that we could have 35% growth, I wouldn't have believed you. But here's the data. Here's the numbers. Data doesn't lie. You've taught me that, Gary. Data doesn't lie. And he was thrilled. And you know what was really cool about it? Hey, the extra income is great. The growing practice is great. The value of the practice going up, is great. But he said, I'm enjoying dentistry more than I ever have. And I actually feel less stress, even though we've grown 35%. He said, I never imagined that happening. So pretty cool outcome.
Absolutely, Eddie. And, I think a lot of what we're going to talk about today, correct me if I'm wrong, are some of the, not all of the, a few of those strategies and ideas. And I think the benefit your clients have is you provide a structured environment because we can all easily get, lost and go in 10 different directions with 10 different ideas. But when you provide structure, when you provide a framework that has worked for 43 years, they have an unfair advantage. They go from being in the bottom 10 or 20 or 30% of practices to, in many times, in the top 5 to 10% of practices in terms of profitability, in terms of growth, all kinds of metrics.
Yeah, I made it my life's work to study world-class practices. And world-class practices are growing practices. They're growing. They might hit plateaus, but the goal is to, if you track practice growth over a period of time, it doesn't look like a linear bar graph. It doesn't look like a graph that goes up at, say, a 45-degree angle. It doesn't look that way. It looks that way academically, but it doesn't work that way in real life. What it really looks like is a set of stairs. You jump up and then you plateau. You jump up and plateau, jump up and plateau, jump up and plateau. And the goal is to make that plateau, the stair tread of the stairs, as short as possible. Right. You want to make that plateau as short as possible. And oftentimes, if we can start, oftentimes it is framed as part of the practice purpose as a noble cause. It's framed in a noble way. And what I mean by that is that when it comes to, creating the vision and the direction for the team, it's not framed in numbers. But the numbers are a byproduct of what happened, but it's not the reason why we're doing this. It's all about changing more patients' lives. It's about changing more patients' lives is the framework around where growth becomes something that people want to be part of, team members want to be part of. The largest generational group today in our society, this should not come as a surprise to anyone. The largest generational group, this just happened towards the end of last year, 2022. Prior to the end of 2022, the largest generational group were baby boomers.
Right.
But towards the end of 2022, that changed. And now the largest generational group are millennials. Millennials. And that's simply because the baby boom generation are dying off.
Yes.
They're diminishing where, you know, the millennials are in the peak, you know, their prime. And one of the, it's dangerous to talk about any generational group in broad generalities. There's a lot of different people, you know, not all baby boomers are the same. Not all Gen Xers are the same. Not all millennials are the same. But there is a cool characteristic about millennials. It's likely, doctor, that the largest generational group among your team members is the same largest generation group among our population, which are millennials.
Millennials.
And if you have millennials working for you, which you probably do, one of the characteristics that's very cool that you can tap into is generally millennials want to be part of something that's bigger than themselves. They want to be part of a cause. They want to be part of something that they're contributing to in some small way. And that can be your practice, and that can be providing more life-changing dentistry to people in our community. So we lead with a noble cause. So part of what I wanted to do is get very granular with you in this episode. A lot of times we come up with, dentists come up with platitudes, you know, the like big picture things they want to do. But I want to break it down into a very granular detail. And if you notice, we called this episode Your Monthly Growth Plan. Your Monthly Growth Plan. This episode is going to be published November 1st. So it's rather timely in that it's being published on the first day of the month. And what I mean by your monthly growth plan is, what are you going to do during the month of November to achieve your growth objective? That's how granular I want to make it. Because if growth is just some platitude that you want to experience, it becomes a wish.
Right.
Right, Aaron?
Correct.
Like, yeah, I wish I could grow. Well, wishes are great. I want to get very detailed and figure out, what do you need to do to make that wish come true? What is your, and I want you to do it every month. Now, you don't have to like lose sleep over this, but every month talk about, what am I going to do in this month to achieve my growth objective? And I would like you to do that long enough to where it becomes a habit. And it becomes a habit of you doing that each and every month. And again, this doesn't have to be heavy. It doesn't have to be something that consumes you. It doesn't have to be something you lay awake at night. But what are you going to do this month? I've got this many work days. We're doing this, this. What am I going to do this month to facilitate growth? Our goal has been to grow by at least 10% every year. And that was measured by collections, because collections are real money in the bank account, to grow by 10% every year. And that was in years where we weren't adding increased providers. We weren't adding more hygiene days. We weren't adding another hygienist. We weren't adding another doctor. On months and years when we were adding more hygienists, more hygiene days, another doctor, then we wanted to grow 10% plus the contribution we would get from the additional producers. And if you grow 10% every year, and you heard me talk about this in the opening comment, in 6.8 years, your practice will double. That's a very different practice, isn't it, Aaron? And if you're young enough to do that again, then another 6.8 years, the practice doubles again. So the $1 million practice, 6.8 years later, it's a $2 million practice. Do it again for another 6.8 years, it's a $4 million practice. Very, very different. So the economics of growth are something we need to talk about. Your profitability on the top dollars is very, very, very attractive. In other words, if we can grow with the same team in the same hours, same team, same hours, all your fixed expenses stay the same. The expenses that go up are your variable expenses that are related to doing more dentistry. And there's really only two categories of variable expenses in dentistry. And that would be lab, if you use an outside lab. My budget for outside lab, if you don't have CAD/CAM or CERAC, my budget for outside lab is 8% of your revenue, 8% of your revenue. If you are using CERAC, my budget is 4% of your revenue. Let's use the higher number, So we err on the side of being conservatives. So your budget for lab is 8% of your revenue. And the only other expense theoretically that goes up is your consumable supplies. The more dentistry you do, the more consumable supplies are going to go up. And my budget for consumable supplies is 6% of revenue. So Naren, 8 plus 6 equals 14%.
Right.
Theoretically, that means theoretically that your profitability on those growth dollars, is 84%, 86%, 86%. But let's add another. So 8 plus 6 is 12. 8 plus 6 is 14. Let's add another 6% for miscellaneous expenses that go up. So 8 plus 6 plus 6 equals 20%. So let's say your overhead on the growth dollars is 20%, meaning your profitability, if you look at it in reverse, your profitability on those growth dollars is 80%. Pretty darn attractive, isn't it, Naren?
Absolutely.
So I want you to really get your arms around the economy of growth, the economics of growth, because your first collection dollars go to pay all your fixed expenses. You really make all your money on the top dollars. So let's talk about some strategies to grow. And we want to grow at least 10% a year. You're welcome to sub whatever percentage you're comfortable with. And maybe it's larger than that. But here's some specific things you can do. I'll number these and kind of talk about each one in some detail. Then I'll go to the next one. Number one, I want you to get really good at adding same-day dentistry. Now, Naren, the term same-day dentistry has two different meanings in the dental profession. One meaning has to do with using CERAC or CAD-CAM dentistry, meaning that you're going to prepare the tooth for a crown and you're going to provide the crown in the same day because of the in-office technology that you have with CERAC. Now, that is an accurate definition of same-day dentistry, but that's not the context that I'm using in here. The context I'm using here is that we're going to add dentistry to our schedule the same day. We're going to add treatment to our schedule that isn't already in our schedule when we start in the morning huddle. We're going to start in the morning huddle. We look for opportunities to make the most of the day. Now, I've done some serious study around this. World-class practices, which I'd like to think, Doctor, you either have one or are aspiring to be one as a listener of the Thriving Dentist Show, world-class practices end up with more production at the end of the day than they started in the morning huddle 80% of the time. Think how magical that is, Naren.
Yes.
They don't hit it 100% of the time. But 4 out of 5 days, in other words, they looked at what their production was in the morning huddle, and then at the end of the day, they ended up north of that number. They ended up with more than that. More average practices or less than average practices go backwards. Why do they go backwards, Naren? So why would they go backwards if they have X scheduled that morning huddle, but at the end of the day, that number is actually lower than they started with? What would be the main reason why that happens?
I think the reason it happens, Gary, is because of no-shows and cancellations, right? You know, people...
Cancellation, no-shows. Yeah. You hit it right in the head. And then, that's a reality in every practice. I wish I could wave my magic wand and eliminate those from any of us having to experience those. I can show you some ways to radically reduce them. But cancellation no-shows are a reality. And yet those world-class practices have cancellation no-shows as well.
Yeah.
Maybe they've reduced them, but they have them. But they still end up with more. And one of the ways they do that is they're totally dialed in to adding in same-day dentistry. They look at the morning huddle, they look at the schedule, and they look at who do I see in hygiene today that has unscheduled treatment plans? In other words, treatment that's been recommended that remains to be completed. And they look at those very intentionally. Maybe Naren has some fillings on the upper left that are asymptomatic, they don't hurt, and yet it remains to be completed. The hygienist can say to you, if we plan this out in the morning huddle, the hygienist can say to you, Naren, I see that doctors recommended some fillings on the upper left. These fillings don't get better on their own. Left to their own devices, the decay only gets worse. Right now, we know we could replace those fillings, with new fillings. But if we wait till it hurts, it might be something a lot more complicated, like a root canal and crown. Now, Naren, I don't know if this will work for you, but if you could, you're scheduled for a hygiene appointment. But at the end of your hygiene appointment, we could move you over here to this room and doctor could do those fillings for you today, save you a trip. And now remember what time of the year that this episode is being published. We might also be able to say, Naren, our insurance coordinator took a look at it. Looks like you have some benefits left this year. And remember how your insurance works. If you don't use those benefits, you lose them. When the clock strikes midnight, you know, when the ball in Times Square drops at midnight on December 31st, if you haven't used those benefits, they don't roll over for you for the next year. You lose them. They go back to the fat cats at the insurance company. So not only could we save you a trip, but we could help you utilize those benefits that you have. Now, that's not going to work 100% of the time, but world-class practices, this is part of the everyday thinking. We look at opportunity to add emergencies, and we look for a morning emergency time and afternoon emergency time. And maybe there's an opportunity to do more than palliative treatment if we have an emergency patient. We look at services that can be auxiliary driven. For example, whitening would be a good case of that. Hey, because that doesn't impact the doctor's time. If we have the room for it, and many offices do, then we look for opportunity to add auxiliary driven treatment. So that, again, we can grow the practice based on the patients that we're seeing today in our practice. All right, tip number two. So tip number one is embrace adding same-day dentistry. Tip number two is get your hygiene occupancy to 92% or above. Now, hygiene occupancy is a term that we use with our clients. What it means is of the available hygiene appointments you have in your practice this month, what percent of those got filled with a butt in the seat? You know, I borrowed the term from the hotel industry. We hear about hotel occupancy, Naren. Yes. And if a hotel says, hey, we had 92% occupancy last night, that meant that of the available rooms, of all the rooms they had available, 92% of them got filled. So our goal is to have hygiene occupancy at 92% or above. By the way, that's a very difficult goal. Now, how does that serve our growth plan? Because if we keep hygiene filled, it gives us growth from the hygiene production. Plus, it allows us to do more doctor exams that represent, you know, potential treatment that could be put on our schedule. In some cases, could even be put on the schedule same day. So getting hygiene occupancy to 92% or above. And we do that primarily through a dual confirmation system. One, we have a default confirmation system for our everyday loyal patients. And that reminder system is they get reminder, appointment reminders, 7 days, 3 days, 2 days in advance, 7/3/2. They can respond back to any of those. We send them primarily by text. They can respond back and opt out of future messages. If they opt out of future messages, then they get one more reminder the day before. But we have a second hygiene appointment reminder protocol for our at-risk patients. And I'm using the term at-risk, meaning at-risk of not showing up. Normally, at-risk is used as a medical term. But in this case, I'm using it as a behavioral term. They're at the risk of not showing up. They get a different sequence. They get the first reminder 14 days in advance. The second one, 7 days. Then it goes 7/6/5/4/3/2. Yes, we are stalking them at this point. They can respond back and opt out of future messages. And if they do, they get a reminder the day before. But most of these people, almost all of them, don't respond to anything. That's why they don't show up. They don't respond to any of this. They made the appointment 6 months ago and then don't respond. So we send them, we are stalking them at this point. We send them one last message 2 days in advance. And if it was you, Naren, the message would say, you know, Naren, this is Susan, reaching out to you from your dental office. We have you scheduled in 2 days for a hygiene appointment. However, I haven't heard back from you to confirm that appointment. If you'd like that appointment, I need to hear back by 2 o'clock today. If I don't hear back from you by 2 o'clock, you'll no longer have that appointment. It's yours if you want it. You just have to let me know you're coming. And then if they don't respond, we take it away and we fill it now. The hygiene schedule coordinator has 2 days to fill that appointment. Has 2 days. It's very likely that she can fill it. That's one of the ways that you get to 92% or above in hygiene occupancy. Number three, this is both a behavioral and a tactical tip. We've got to get your team to embrace growth. We've got to get your team to embrace the idea of growing, that a growing practice is a thriving practice. And we want everyone to be involved at every department. Your hygienists need to know what they can do to support that. Your assistants need to know what they can do to support that. Your admin team needs to know what they can do to support that. And we want to really frame that around that noble cause. That's, we want to help more people in our community enjoy the benefits of great oral health. When everybody's on board, it's amazing the results that you can get when everybody, not just you, doc, but when everybody is embracing the concept of growth. Now, I'm going to get very tactical with you with a fourth tip. And the fourth tip that I'm going to suggest in terms of your monthly growth plan is to have a designated doctor scheduling coordinator, someone that is accountable and responsible for filling your schedule. The act of having a dedicated doctor scheduling coordinator where that individual knows what our monthly goal is, what we're going to do, and she's scheduling toward that will go a long way towards making it. It's now no longer a wish, but now it's being tactically figured out day to day. So there's those four tips. Embrace the concept of adding same-day dentistry, tip one. Number two, get your hygiene occupancy to 92% or above. Tip three, get your entire team supportive of growth. And tip four, having a dedicated doctor scheduling coordinator. And now I want you to put that in the context of what are you all going to do this month to make that happen? Look very granular at the details of this month and break that down to day to day. What do we do every day to make that happen? Well, Naren, we've got some great questions coming up. Let's hit pause on the coaching and action segment and go to the Thriving Dentist Q&A segment.
Welcome back to the Thriving Dentist Q&A segment. This is Naren again. Gary, I have four questions for you for the Q&A segment. Today, we talked about your monthly growth plan, So these four questions, Gary, are specific to the coaching and action segment you just completed. The very first question I have from one of our listeners is, I have noticed that we typically go backwards every single day in terms of production. I look at the amount we have scheduled during the morning huddle, and then I look at them again at the end of the day, and usually we are producing less than we started because of cancellations and no-shows. This is my question to you, Gary. How can I turn this around?
Well, doctor, please know that what you just described is normal, is absolutely, that happens to the majority of practices. You go backwards. So I think you've already taken the first step, which is begin by recognizing that. A couple of very specific things that I would do is in the morning huddle, have one of your admin team members review all of your hygiene patients, and in particular, highlight any of your hygiene patients that have an unscheduled treatment plan. Start by identifying those. And then in the morning huddle, as you go through the hygiene schedule, you'll know which patients have an unscheduled treatment plan. And look at opportunities to add those into today's schedule. So the goal is to add more in than what happens to fall out through cancellation and no-shows. But the second recommendation I'm going to have is we've got to recreate a culture in your practice where cancellation and no-shows are not encouraged and they're not accepted. Naren, Dr. Phil, the television psychologist personality, has a saying that I like. And his saying goes, we train people how to treat us.
Correct.
I believe that to be true. And I believe that to be true in terms of cancellation and no-shows. Like, for example, when someone calls the office and says to one of your admin team members, oh, Susan, I have an appointment later today, but I'm not going to be able to make it. So oftentimes the words that accidentally come out of the patient, the team member's mouth is, oh, that's okay. And you know what? It's not okay. We have to watch it, how we're subconsciously creating the behaviors that are happening in your practice. Another thing that you can do is, and this might go a long way to changing the, having the tide completely change in your practice. Doctor, when you bring in a new patient to the practice, imagine something like this happening at the end of the first appointment in your practice. Imagine one of your business team members sitting down with you, Naren, let's say you're the new patient. And just before, we're done checking you out and you're done with your appointment, she says, Naren, first of all, it's been so great to meet you. We love seeing new patients here at our practice, and welcome to our patient family. I'm glad you've chosen a great office. We're going to take great care of you. Hey, before you leave today, Naren, can I take a minute to explain what you can expect from us as an active patient in our practice? What you can expect? And I'm going to nod my head. In a neuro-linguistic programming, if I'm nodding my head, what are you going to do?
I'm going to nod my head too.
Say, yeah. Naren, four things you can expect from us. Number one, I know it sounds kind of corny, but we think of our patients as patient family. And because of that, we're going to provide you, number two, the highest quality care using the latest advances, the latest technology, because that's what we would want if we were a patient here. Number three, we stand behind our work. If something doesn't meet our standards, we redo it until it does. Now, we actually have a warranty that I'll share with you that if any treatment's recommended, I'll go over that with you. But just at this point, know that we stand behind our work. And number four, we have a way for you to reach our doctors after hours. And we hand a business card that has the after hours protocol. Now, if it's a routine thing, you just leave a message at the office, that's fine. But if anything is happening with a dental concern or emergency with you or your family, here's how you can reach our doctors after hours. Naren, now that I've shared with you things you can expect from us, may I take a second and explain what we expect from you?
And absolutely.
I'm nodding my head, and Naren's going to do what?
I'm going to say yes.
He's going to nod his head yes. Just one thing. Naren, we expect that if you make an appointment in our practice, you show up. You show up for that appointment. Now. Now we're going to soften it. Now, Naren, we're family people. We understand things happen. We get it. Things happen. In fact, I saw a bumper sticker the other day that says things happen. Well, the first word wasn't things, but stuff does happen. And we understand that. And when stuff does happen, all we ask is you kindly give us at least 48 hours advance notice to change an appointment. Naren, does that sound fair to you?
That sounds fair, Getty.
Yeah. So now what I'm doing is I'm setting the expectation right at the beginning. So maybe the best way to end up with more production in your schedule, get more people to show up, which is to train them to keep their appointments. Now, that's not going to work 100% of the time, but you'd be amazed at how often that will work to train the expectation that the patient gives you at least 48 hours if they need to change an appointment. Well, great question, Doctor.
Thank you, Getty. This is my second question, Gary. Gary, the insight you provided about my insurance adjustments being a marketing expense has been a huge breakthrough for me. I now realize I am paying, within quotes, 45% of my revenue on marketing as a PPO practice. My goal is to spend less than 2%, as you suggested, on marketing within 12 to 18 months. What actions can I take this month to change my marketing spend as a percentage of revenue?
All right, I'm going to answer that question two ways. Naren, would you put in the show notes the Thriving Dentist show that we did that's called Your Six-Step Plan to Successfully Resign from PPO Plans? Your Six-Step Plan.
Okay.
So that was an episode we did. It's one of our all-time highest number of download episodes. We'll put that in the show notes. So just go to thrivingdentist.com. Click on podcast, look for this episode, Your Monthly Growth Plan. Hopefully you're watching Dr. Mo Budak's videos on the history of dentistry. But in the show notes, you'll also see a link to the episode we did called The Six-Step Plan to Successfully Resign from PPO Plans. So Doctor, the first thing I'm going to ask you to do is listen to that, because inside that episode is all the things you need to do to begin to prep to successfully resign from PPO Plans. The second thing I want you to do right now is to schedule a marketing strategy meeting with Equa. Equa is the marketing strategy, or is the marketing firm we use in my Life Smiles practice. It's also the marketing firm I recommend to my clients. So go to thrivingdentist.com/M, or excuse me, go to Equa, ekwa.com, ekwa.com/MSM. Again, that's ekwa, ekwa.com/MSM. That will open up Lila Stone's scheduling calendar, and you're going to schedule a marketing strategy meeting. You'll learn how you can reduce your marketing spend to get you in the 1% to 2% of your revenue instead of that 45% that you're spending now. Two very specific things to do. Great question.
Absolutely. In the marketing strategy meeting, we will literally give you a blueprint on how you can get to that 2% spend within 12 to 18 months. So you'll not only get a status report on where you stand with Google and marketing in general, but also a blueprint, a plan you can implement. So
Aaron, that ties in nicely to our episode today about growth, because if you're a growing practice, you can actually get that as a percentage to less than 1%.
Right.
We have clients in my coaching that are spending 0.3% of their revenue on marketing, 0.3%. How's that instead of spending 45%? How about that?
Yeah, because all the money you save is now you can invest or, you know, take out as profits.
Yeah, goes right down to your bottom line.
Let me ask you question number three, Gary. In an effort to support growth in my practice, do you think it would make sense to hire an extra dental assistant?
Now, I can actually answer that question very specifically. About a year ago, a very forward-thinking client of mine, this doctor is absolutely the captain of a world-class practice. He said, Gary, I got a question for you that kind of sounds contradictory. As you know, wages, this is a year ago. He said, my wages are going up and up and up, like they are for every dental practice. But I got this crazy idea. I'm thinking of hiring an extra dental assistant. This is a multi-doctor practice. There's actually three dentists in this practice. And he said, the way we schedule, as you know, Gary, is each doctor has two rooms and two assistants. And so they work out of two rooms with two assistants. But he said, Gary, I'm thinking, and the way they do that, by the way, their main room, their main column is scheduled from start to finish with a variety of appointments. They do the rock, sand, water appointment method that I teach. And then the second column is an overflow column. And on any given day, that overflow call might be scheduled 30 or 40% of the time. Now, the reason it isn't scheduled 100% of the time isn't because they don't have enough patients. It's because whatever they're doing in room one is captive and they can't have the doctor in two places at once. So he's asking the question, you know, I'm thinking of hiring an extra dental assistant. So I said, doctor, you know, sometimes the best way to answer a question is with a question. If you don't mind, may I answer your question with the question? He said, should I consider hiring an extra assistant? And I said, what would you do with that person? And without a moment's hesitation, he said, you know what, Gary? I mean, he literally clicked it. So you know what we could do? We could, and he rattled off a bunch of things. He said, if we have an emergency patient, we could oftentimes do more definitive treatment on the emergency patient. I could train the assistant to do more auxiliary-driven procedures, you know, like whitening, like becoming an orthodontic assistant and being able to deliver aligners for my Invisalign patients. I could train. We also do 6-month smiles. I could train her to be able to change the wire, you know, for the 6-month smile protocol for that adult orthodontic method. I could train her as backup for the admin team, so that we will answer. One of the things I want to do is I want to get that missed calls during business hours down to less than 5%. Right now, we're close to 10%. If I could train her as backup on phones, that gives me a better opportunity to capture more calls as they come in. And Aaron, he went on with 3 or 4 other ideas on what he would do with the extra assistant. And I said, doctor, based on your answer, I would 100% green light the hiring of an extra assistant. You already have it figured out. This isn't just a body you're going to hire, but you have very specific direction on where that team member is going to help your practice. And I, you know, we're on a Zoom call and I gave him 2 thumbs up. Go for it. He said, I'm glad you said that. I'm going to do it. Well, it's a year later. And guess what, Aaron? That decision has been one of the best decisions this practice has made to be able to grow and make the most of every single day. It's kind of contradictory, isn't it? When we're thinking, I got to get my wages under control. But if you have the plan for that, it could be a great decision. Great question.
Thank you, Gary. Let me ask you question number four. This is the last question I have for you. How is the best way to talk about growth with my team members and not have it seem like it's all about money?
What a thoughtful question. You know, at the very beginning, when we started talking about your monthly growth plan, I talked about leading with a noble cause, leading with a noble cause. And really, that is the answer to that question. When you're talking to your team members about this, we want to talk to your team members about our mission, our vision. Our goal is to help more people in our community enjoy the benefits of great oral health. And that has to be something that emanates from every pore in our body. And every one of the team members need to be singing the same tune on that. We want to help more people. The numbers are a byproduct of that. And remember what we said about millennial team members. Millennial team members are very interested in being involved in a cause that's bigger than themselves. And the idea of helping more people in your community achieve great oral health absolutely fits right within, you know, that objective of being involved in something that's bigger than them. You know, there's another more subtle way to do this. Anytime we could treat something conservatively before it's more complicated can benefit the patient. So, Naren, when we can replace those fillings with new fillings and avoid the possibility of a root canal and crown, then we're helping you. So there's so many different ways we can really lead with a noble purpose, but really that's the answer to that question. You lead with the noble purpose and the example of helping as many people in your community have great oral health. Those are especially useful questions today, Naren. Thanks to our listeners for submitting those. Well, as we wrap up today, some thank yous are in order. Naren, I want to thank you for supporting the podcast, being a co-host. Also want to thank all the team members at Equa. I believe you're over 200 team members now. Is that headcount accurate?
250, yeah. 200 working just in Equa, and then, of course, 50 people working on other projects. Yeah.
Nice. Well, if you'd like the power of 250 dedicated team members to help you master marketing, set up that marketing strategy meeting, equa.com/MSM. Also, if you would like some coaching, maybe it's to help you successfully resign from PPO plans, maybe it's to grow at least 10% every year, please know we are welcoming at this point, we are welcoming new clients in the Thriving Practice Academy. If you'd like to schedule a Zoom meeting with me, we call it a coaching strategy meeting. Go to thrivingdentist.com/CSM. That opens up my calendar where you can schedule a one-hour Zoom meeting with me. The purpose of that meeting is for me to learn about your practice and for you to learn about our coaching and determine if there might be a good fit. Please know we welcome the opportunity to schedule that coaching strategy meeting. On that note, I simply want to thank all of you as well. Thank you for the privilege of your time, for listening to The Thriving Dentist Show. And Naren and I look forward to connecting with you on the next podcast episode.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride. Don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. And when you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.